All right. So, or good afternoon, I guess, depending on when you're watching this. So today is the first day of the second week in the semester, week 19, and we are doing the second installment of notes in Unit 5, which is the periodic table. So today what you're going to need, your packet, and you also need your periodic table that you colored, your nice periodic table. We're going to write one note on the top of this, and then you need to be able to read it for different elements, but we're going to end up putting valence electrons on here that you can have for the rest of the year. You need, like I said, you need your packet. There is a bellwork in here. There's a blank periodic table we're going to fill in, and there is also then the practice worksheet that we have for today. The blank periodic table we're going to eventually fill in. I do have the key beneath here, so if I kind of go too fast, please make sure you pause the program and do this at your leisure, but you probably want some colors because we're going to write four different trends on this blank periodic table today. But the first thing that we want to do after the blank periodic table, it says periodic table bellwork number one. And so what we want to do is I would like for you to pause the program, and you can use your notes from last week if you want. A couple of these things were actually on the quiz, so hopefully you did very well. If you didn't, here's your chance to review for before this week's quiz. This week's quiz is on Thursday, because we do not have school this Friday. Pause the program here. Try to do the five questions that says periodic table bellwork number one. Once you've done those, then go ahead and restart the program and we'll see how you did. All right, let's see how you guys did on this bellwork. So the first question asks, what does the word periodic mean? And the word periodic means having a regular repeating pattern. And so all over this periodic table today, we're going to discuss four particular ones, have trends. There are way more than this, but we just picked these four to go over with you guys today. The periodic table of the elements has repeating patterns all over it. Next question, who is credited with inventing the first periodic table? Well, that would be Mendeleev. He rearranged the atoms or the elements that people were finding based on similar properties, but also by increasing atomic mass. That was kind of his claim to fame, that he decided to use increasing atomic mass. However, he didn't know about atomic number. They didn't know you could count number of protons, which we now know. So now in the most modern day periodic table, we know that it increases by one proton. Every time you add a proton, you get a new element with a new set of properties. Another proton makes a new element and things like that. On the periodic table, groups go up and down. And they are elements in the same group have similar chemical and physical properties. Okay. Elements in the same group have similar chemical and physical properties. Periods go across. So the first row, the second row, the third row, all that kind of good stuff. And those follow a repeating pattern across the periodic table. So the first row is always the alkaline earth, then you go the transition, then you go around. So it's always the same repeating pattern. A couple of notable ones that you should be able to name. And we were able to name these for last week, so hopefully you still have this and it was easy for you to then see and answer these ones. Remember, we number the columns or the groups with Roman numerals, so hopefully it was not that hard for you to know. The group two are the alkaline earth metals. Group eight are the noble gases. Group one are the alkali metals. And then group seven are the reactive halogens. And then down here, check and see if you were right, but you were asked to put diamonds and squares and circles. This was kind of like the question that you had last week on your quiz to see if you understand the difference between groups and periods. Okay, so if you need to check this a little bit closer, go ahead and pause it, or the key is posted beneath this lecture, okay? Awesome. So what we're going to get into next is we're going to get into our periodic table notes. So wherever you're keeping your notes, it's actually going to be a lot of moving parts today. I think you should have your notebook or your piece of paper in front of you. Go ahead and label up periodic table trends notes or periodic table notes number two, whatever you would like. You need your regular periodic table near you, and you need your blank periodic table. We're going to kind of move around between all three of those items here. It's a busy note-taking day. Okay. So as you can see on my little image up here, as you're getting yourself situated, is there's lots of different trends. There's trends in reactivity. There's trends in size. There's trends in ionization energy, electron affinity, a ton of stuff. But we're going to go over four main trends with you today. So here we go. You need your periodic table and your blank periodic table. Let's get it. The first trend, trend number one. Trend number one talks about atomic diameter or size, atomic size. You can think about it. If this is the nucleus, is it small or is it big? So we're talking about atomic diameter. Sometimes you'll hear it called atomic radius. You guys probably know the difference between a radius and a diameter. But basically, we're talking about how big it is. Okay. And there are two parts to this trend. Two parts. One trend that goes down the periodic table and one trend that goes across the periodic table. We'll start with down the periodic table. As you go down the periodic table, atoms get larger as you go down a group. Atoms get larger as you go down the group. Okay, don't write on your nice periodic table here, but I'm just gonna show you an example. So as we go down this periodic table, they get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. So in group one, hydrogen is the smallest element. Francium is the largest element. And they will ask you probably on a test or quiz or assessment opportunity, why? And the idea of why is if you just look at this periodic table here, hydrogen has a nucleus and it has one electron. And then lithium has another energy level because it has three electrons. And then sodium has another energy level because I would have to draw six more electrons. And then potassium has another energy level for more electrons. Rubidium has 37 electrons. Cesium has 55 electrons. So as you go down a group, because you have more and more electrons you need to house, you have to add all of these energy levels in order to hold those electrons. So it should make a lot of sense that hydrogen with one little electron is small. Okay, one energy level, one proton, woo. But francium down here with 87 electrons is humongous. It's a huge element because it has so many electrons making it so big. Okay, so I think that's an easy, hopefully, trend to understand. Oops, sorry. Atoms get larger as they go down a group. There are more energy levels because there are more electrons. Trying to pace myself here. So if I go too fast, please don't hesitate to pause me. Let's talk about going across because it's the opposite. Going across, atoms get smaller as you go across the period. And now this one's a little bit more challenging to understand because, and we'll talk about it. It's not as easy as cut and dry. So we get smaller as we go across and we get larger as we go down. So if you're looking here, sodium is big, magnesium gets smaller, 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 smaller as you go across. Argon would be the smallest in its period. Sodium would be the largest in its period. And now to the reason why. Well, when you are in a period, you are in the same energy level. All of your electrons are in the same energy level. And so let's compare. So sodium has 11 protons in its nucleus and 11 electrons around its nucleus. Now, the positives and the negatives have a pull on each other. And the more positives you have and the more negatives you have, the stronger the pull gets to get. So as you have sodium having 11 pluses and 11 minuses, they pull hard. But then when I add, for the next one over here, magnesium, another proton and another electron, it can pull even harder. And then as I go over to aluminum, okay, I can pull even harder. And then as you keep going over here, every time you add a proton and an electron, that difference in the magnetic ability here, the positive and the positive and the negative, pulls harder, okay? Making that nucleus be able to flex in the size of that atom, okay? So over here, the nucleus can't pull that hard, but as you add electrons, that nucleus can pull harder and harder on those electrons as you go across the periodic table. Nucleus pulls harder on electrons as you go across the periodic table. Okay, so that's trend number one. What I would like to do is I would like to then have you guys kind of visually do these on your blank periodic table. So on the back of this periodic table is another blank periodic table. If you want to write trends at the top, you can. Give it a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, going down the periods. And then Roman numerals 1 to 8 on the top for your groups. All right. So the first thing that I did, and you might, like I said, if you have different colors here, you might want to make each trend a different color or whatever. The first trend, like we just talked about, is atomic size. We said, whoop, atoms get larger as you go down the group because they add more and more energy levels, holding more and more electrons, if you will. And then I drew teeny tiny, got bigger and bigger and bigger until the largest element in a group is always at the bottom. So the bottom here houses the largest elements that we have. Awesome. Okay. Then I said, as we go across, atoms get smaller as you go across the period because that nucleus is pulling harder and harder every time you add another electron and a proton. That magnetic difference goes ahead and pulls those atoms smaller. And I just picked, I don't know, a period 3 to get smaller, 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 until the smallest atoms are always over here on the right-hand side. Okay, I hope I'm not going too fast. Let's generalize this into one major trend, okay? So if we have small up here because it's at the top and over to the right, that means we would then have largest over here. So if I asked you what was the biggest element you could find, the biggest element that we have is at the bottom to the left. Francium is the largest element that we have or that we know of on this planet. And the smallest element atom that we have is helium. Okay, so it's an overall trend, small to large. Perfect. All right, so that's trend number one. How are we feeling with trend number one? Good. Trend number two is something that we're going to teach you guys right now, but we'll have a lot to do in the next unit. We're actually going to put this on your nice periodic table. You will use this every single day because you always need to know number of valence electrons and good stuff like that. So valence electrons, valence electrons. Valence electrons are the electrons in the highest most or the outermost energy level. They are the electrons that are all the way at the very, very outside of an atom. Because you know we said you have 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6. And all these electrons are found in these energy levels that radiate out from the nucleus. Valence electrons are the electrons found in the outermost energy level. Now, the very important thing about valence electrons is that they are the only electrons that are allowed to be used in bonding. So often people start to forget how many extra electrons you have because it doesn't matter how many are close to you. The ones that are on the outermost energy level are the only ones you're going to use in bonding. So that you can only give or take those electrons. So we spend a lot of time focusing on those. The only electrons used in bonding. And this trend is extremely simple. One of the very beautiful pieces of the periodic table that once you rearrange these guys in increasing atomic mass or atomic number now, is that in order to figure out how many valence electrons an element has, all you have to do is look at the group number. The group number, okay, tells you the number of valence electrons that an atom has. The group number tells you the number of electrons, valence electrons that an atom has, not the total. Okay. Because as you can see, something like silicone has 14 electrons. I get that. But what we're saying is because it's in group four, it has four valence electrons, four electrons on its outer shell that it can bond with. So let's go ahead and take a look with your blank periodic table. I chose a different color. I chose green this time, and I kind of wrote off to the side that this is the key, that my valence electrons are going to be in green. Okay, there is an exception here, but let's get through this first. So in group one, every single element in group one has one valence electron ready for bonding. Everything in group two has two valence electrons available for bonding. This B group down here, you actually have to do a mathematical formula to figure out how many valence electrons. So that whole sunken down group, we're not going to worry about that right now. We'll teach you how to figure out their charge later. Group three has three valence electrons available. You'll probably see the pattern here. Group four has four valence electrons available. Five, six, seven, and eight valence electrons available for bonding. So everything in that group has that many valence electrons, all of them, except one thing, and we'll talk about that here in a moment. All right, so what I would like for you to do, and heavens help me, I just made this such a mess, is I would like for you to take your nice periodic table that we've been working with. Stop. All right, take your nice periodic table, and we're going to formally write the number of valence electrons each element has on here. So above group one, one valence electrons, two have two valence electrons, three, four, five, six, seven, and eight valence electrons. So keep that near you because I'm going to ask you in your notes here, not that you have to write it down, but just to look around here. So everything in group one, one available bonding electron. In group two, two available bonding electrons. Three, four, five, all the way up through the last one. Now let's talk about the exception. In the noble gases, they all say you have eight available electrons for bonding. However, one of these things is never going to have eight valence electrons. So hopefully what you can see here, helium has two electrons, and they're two valence electrons. So I sometimes, even on my nice one, write 2E right there to remind yourself. Because he has two protons, he's only going to ever have two electrons, and he is stable with that because he fills 1s with 2, and so that is filled. So he is stable. Okay, but he's over there in group eight. You would think if you're like, hey, well, if he has two valence electrons, why wouldn't helium go over here then? Okay, and the reason why, I mean, that would make sense with that trend, but the reason why we put helium over here is because he's a nonmetal, and more importantly, we put helium over here because he's inert. You guys saw last week on the demonstration where we blew up the balloons that the helium just popped. And the hydrogen exploded. So if it was over on the left-hand side, okay, it need to be reactive, but they stick him over there in noble gases because he is inert, okay? All right, so your exception, if you want to write it down in your notes, I don't think you have to, but helium is the exception to that rule, and he only has two valence electrons. All right, so I don't want you to write this down. I want you to get your periodic table in front of you now that you've written the number at the top, and I want you to take a look at find potassium for me. How many valence electrons does potassium have? Good, one. How many valence electrons does sulfur have? Good. Four. Oh, six, excuse me. I'm getting confused with silicone. Helium, how many valence electrons? There you go. It's in group eight. You probably wanted to say eight, but it's only two. How many valence electrons does oxygen have? Good. Six. How many valence electrons does argon have? Can you find him? He's all the way over to the right. He's a noble gas. So he's going to have eight. Strontium. And again, if you don't understand how I'm doing this, I guess I should, if you were sitting here. Strontium has two valence electrons. Oh. How about tin? All you have to do is find it and look at what group it's in. It's in group four, so it has four valence electrons. Okay, that's trend number two. All right. Okay, so we have the purple trend and the green trend. We have our periodic table. Let's do trend number three. Trend number three we've kind of already done, but it doesn't hurt to do it again because eventually we're going to talk about charges and people tend to forget this. So trend number three talks about how metals become positive because they give away their negative electrons. Metals become positive. Remember, the word for a positive ion is a cation. Because they give away their negative electrons. So if I have 10 protons and 10 electrons, if I give my electrons away, then I start to become positive in my net charge. All right, very nice. So what I did on my blank periodic table, and I did mine in orange, is I said that metals, and we kind of did this on the other side, metals on this side tend to give their electrons away, and they become positive in charge. If somebody's giving away electrons, that means somebody needs to be taking electrons. So we know, back to our notes here, that nonmetals form anions when they gain or take in extra negative electrons. So if I was doing the same thing, if I had 10 protons and 10 electrons and I was neutral, if I gained more negative electrons, I would become negative in a net charge. Awesome. So on my blank periodic table, where we went, I said nonmetals take electrons and they become negative. All right. If I'm going too fast, go ahead, pause me. Things like that. We are going to actually take some of the notes that you guys did last week, and we are going to use those and just put them on this periodic, on the blank periodic table, because we haven't done that yet. So the next thing that we're going to do probably already looks familiar to you. If you already have this written down, then I would just find it, or you can just put it on your blank periodic table. Don't rewrite this. But remember that the alkali metals are extremely reactive metals. Alkaline earth metals are reactive. Transition metals transition from metals to nonmetals. Rare earth metals are rarely found on Earth. Oops. Halogens are extremely reactive nonmetals, and noble gases are inert. So we already wrote this down, or we already talked about it. Don't write this down right here in your notes. What I'd like for you to do is we're going to go to your blank periodic table, and we're going to put this information on here. I wrote this all in red. So what I wrote is that I kind of just wrote the most, and wherever this makes sense for you, the most reactive metals are this first group here. And then I kind of drew an arrow that said most reactive metals. Then slightly reactive metals are my alkaline earth metals, still reactive, just not as crazy reactive as the first one. So if you want to write reactive, but these are the most reactive. I just don't know if you want to write over your size. It's just too much. So much stuff going on. Then I would outline the entire sunken down part. These transition metals, what is special about them is that they transition from really metallic-y here on the left-hand side to non-metallic-y on the right-hand side. They're called the transition metals because they transition from very metallic elements to more non-metallic elements on the right side. Awesome. The ones down here were called the rare earth metals because they were rarely found on Earth. So however you want to. And if you want to take a moment and color this in again, that's fine. However you want to do this, just you have to know about the properties of each section. Remember these next ones, we just called this the boron group, the carbon, the nitrogen, and the oxygen group. This is really hard to put trends on those because it has a lot of different things in it. If you look at it, those have metals, nonmetals, metalloids, all that kind of stuff. So there are trends in here, but we're going to kind of ignore those for a little bit. And we are just going to call those the boron, carbon, oxygen, and nitrogen group. And then, helium has its good old little two electrons up there if you would like. Then the most reactive nonmetals we have is your group 7. These are the halogens. These are the halogens. All right. And then the last group that we have, these bad boys are inert, which means that they do not react at all. You guys saw the helium. All the helium did was the helium just popped. Didn't blow up, didn't react at all with the ignition from the lit splint. Okay. So again, you just got to make sure you know the different pieces of information about all the different sections on the periodic table for your test that will be this Thursday. Nice. All right. We have one more trend or one more. This is our last trend, but what we have is a little bit more, or one more trend, I guess we should say here, with reactivity. Where did it go? Boom. Trend number 4 is reactivity. Where did it? Let's write reactivity. And there are two trends to this. There's a trend going down on the metal side and the trend going up the non-metal side. So two more parts to our trends here. The first part is that metals, so we're talking about the green ones. Metals tend to become more reactive as you go down a group. Metals, the green ones, become more reactive as you go down the group. Okay, and we're going to show you this in our lecture video or our lab video on Thursday. For instance, if you just went group 1, hydrogen, lithium's more reactive, sodium's more reactive, potassium's more reactive, rubidium, they get more reactive as you go down the group. You don't necessarily have to know the reason why. They just are bigger. They don't really care to have their electron. They're like, I don't care. Just take it from me. I don't even want it. So not that you would have to know the mechanism behind it, but they get more reactive. So this is the most reactive at the bottom, and this is the least reactive at the top. So out of all my metals, if I asked you which metal is the most reactive metal we have on this planet, at the very bottom of the most reactive column, because remember, column 1 are the most reactive ones we have, in the bottom of that, francium is the most reactive metal that we have. Okay. All right. The opposite is true for the nonmetals. Nonmetals become more reactive as you go up the group. Non-metals, okay, so the yellow ones here, the yellow ones, non-metals become more reactive as you go up the group with one very big exception. We're going to see if you can figure this out. Non-metals become more reactive as you go up the group. Awesome. So if I were to ask you, what is the most reactive non-metal, what would you say? There's always somebody that's like, helium. And you're like, oh, I get, because you said way up here, right? Most reactive, going to catch yourself here. Do these guys react at all? The only thing that isn't in this trend are the noble gases. They never react. So they don't count in a reactivity trend because they don't react. They're out. So what is the highest non-metal that we have over here? These are your most reactive non-metals. They're called the halogens. The one at the top of that, winner, winner, chicken dinner, most reactive non-metal we have is fluorine. Okay. Awesome. We're just going to go ahead and put this onto our blank periodic table. I know you're like running out of room. You're like, where am I going to write that? So I just chose another color. I chose pink. And I just wrote on this side, metals become more reactive as you go down the group. And then I wrote FR. Most reactive metal. And then I said they become more reactive as you go up the group. And the most reactive nonmetal is fluorine. Again, I think I started going really fast there at the end. I'm sorry. So if you are holding on, go ahead and pause the program and finish it up, or you can wait and I don't have very much left. And then you can check yourself with the key. I do have the printed out key beneath this lecture. So the last thing that we would do if we had class is there is a practice worksheet for this. And you can find it the next page in your packet. It says periodic trends. This is going to be what this whole quiz is over on Thursday. Okay. Everything's going to be about periodic trends and all that kind of good stuff. So there's lots of really fun ways and fun questions you can ask with that. So to start to see what that looks like, you're going to have this worksheet. The key is posted in the, also beneath here, it's a blue worksheet. I couldn't find my original for some reason. So I had to get the color paper copy one. So the key is here. So I suggest going through doing at least a few of each of one, especially the back. That's going to be kind of how the questions are going to go as we go through a couple. So as it's giving away answers here, circle the atom in each pair that has the largest atomic radius. So if we look here, periodic table, aluminum or boron. Aluminum is here. Boron is here. Remember, they get larger as they go down. So aluminum is larger. So you're going to have to figure out how to compare things like that. We will practice this on Wednesday because it is a little more challenging, but just make sure that you have your kind of one-stop shop study guide here with all of the trends written down that we did today and work on this worksheet for the rest of the time being. And then we have one more lecture tomorrow. We have live class on Wednesday. And then on Thursday, we will have a little lab video, but you also have your quiz because you don't have school this Friday. Thank you guys very much. Let me know if you have any questions. Oh, don't forget your lecture questions right under this video.